Okay, so it is safe and it will safeguard your life as long as you as a rider of jet ski know pretty much well how to ride it carefully, right? And also as an equipment which is allowing you to ride it is flawless, right? If it is flawless and if you know how to ride it in a secure way, and it will actually save your life. But you should be ready with your life jackets to, you know, in order to balance yourself from your unforeseen incidents kind of a thing, right? But similarly, Docker security, if you see that, so it is actually, you know, based on the Linux, it actually uses the Linux host kernel features of security features, right? So though it has all the kind of security features like namespaces, control groups, SC, Linux, SECOM, so various other technologies, right? But still, if you as a user of the technology doesn't know how to use the system and what are the flaws that are existing in the system, and if you are not armed to fix the issues which will come unforeseen, unfortunately, but there are various, because it is an open source technology, there are various bug bounty hunters sitting like out there, and they keep reporting various new bugs. And if you do not know how to, and if you are not armed to fix those issues, right, you will run into issues. So let us very briefly go through some of the issues which have shaken the world in Docker. Is that if you see the Datikov, it is actually a part of Linux kernel feature memory management implementation. It's a flaw in that copy and write system. It actually leads to local privilege escalation. And if you see that run C, it actually affected a lot of containerization technologies, Kubernetes, right? So what it does is it is actually a run C it's a containerization engine feature. It just runs whatever container you give it, right? But the actual problem with that is that, so you, a user or a hacker should be a root on that particular container, root user on that particular container, then only that attack is possible. So he can actually perform the remote code or the root level remote code attacks on the host machine. So, and if you see this, this is called Jack in the Box, okay? So this is actually for the Docker on Windows, okay? So Docker on Windows uses a feature called Windows Host Computer Service Shim. Actually, there was a flaw in that particular technology in a particular function called filepath.join, okay? So whenever you pull a Docker image from a registry and when it tries to unpackage itself, it actually stores that files in a particular directory in your host. So, but the vulnerability that existed in that particular filepath.join. So it was a flaw that, you know, it was not sanitizing the user inputs, right? So actually, through that, attacker was able to delete the files, you know, update the files on your host system, right? And then this is a Vine. Have you heard of this Vine application? Have you ever used it, right? It is nothing but a video sharing application. It just allows you to share 6 seconds of videos. It's actually acquired by Twitter, right? So what happened was that one of the developers of Vine actually uploaded their images not into their private registry, but into a public registry. So public registry is meant for dockerhub.com, is actually meant for, is for the public. Anybody can just download it, whatever is there, right? So what happens once your source code goes public? So you know as a hacker what damage that you can do it, right? But unfortunately, it was for a shorter period of time, so it was actually removed and put it back into the private registry. So why I tried that is, why I covered those issues is that I just wanted to tell you the system as such, is if it is having issues, we have to make sure that you fix them, right? And if there are some unforeseen issues in the open source components, you make sure you upgrade them to the latest releases, right? And know how to use the system correctly, right? So because in case of wine, what happened that though he knows that it is not supposed to be public, he made it private, right? So these are simple mistakes. So I'm here, I'm going to explain you and give you a walkthrough of all the Docker security best practices which you need to consider, okay? So please do not run container as a root. So I'm going to show you a small demo which will tell you why you should not be running. Okay, so here is my Docker file. Okay, so when I build the Docker, so it executes the commands which are part of my Docker file. That is nothing but from Alpine and run apk update bash, right? So I haven't mentioned in my Docker file as what user I should run this container as. So what happens here is that if you see here, Sujatha is a normal user, right? If I try to read, the contents, okay. So let me just show. Okay. So if I try to read the contents here, cat secret dot text outside the container, the permission is denied for me, right? But if I am running this container without specifying as which user I should run, it by default runs it as a root. So if I after running this container, and if I go into the container, if I see myself, I'm a root here, right? So here I can easily read this contents of the secrets.txt file, what it is, right? Okay, so yeah, so do not put sensitive files in your images. So make sure whenever you're creating your Docker file, and I would like to put a disclaimer before I continue further on this. This is only for the core Docker basic thing and not for the orchestrator tool or anything. So just keep that in mind. We'll come to the orchestration security at the later point of time. So in that, don't try to put your sensitive files in your Docker file. What happens is there are many reverse engineering tools that are available. And if you see that CenturyLink Docker file from Medium, it actually, what it does is it actually reverse engineer it and show you what exactly that you're passing as part of your Docker file, right? So if it is less sensitive, you can just pass it as a variable. And if it is more sensitive, like keys and all, if you want to pass it on, make sure you have a Docker secrets feature which is out there. So it actually encrypts your secrets and at rest and also in the transit. So I would like to quickly show you whatever I just told. See, if you see this, I've just created an alias of that particular reverse engineering tool as DF image. And if I try to, you know, reverse engineer it, I can see what exactly I'm passing in my Docker file, right? So you can see this, right? So if there are any weaknesses that are present in the system, they can use it and exploit it further. So how actually you should be passing it, also I would like to discuss quickly. Okay. So make sure, okay. Could you please help me with this? Okay. So I have my secrets.txt, right? I have my secrets.txt in my under EV whatever is a folder, right? So make sure you pass that as your variable. Whenever you are running the Docker, you make sure you run it and pass it as part of a variable, so that when you actually try to see it, you will not actually find that particular file in your when you reverse engineer it, you will not find it as part of your Docker file. And also, so make sure you actually volume mount your files from your host to the container very carefully. Make sure all your important and sensitive directories like etc or user or anything for that matter, make sure you send them as a read only. So can you see here, Docker run, whenever you're running a Docker, you use Docker run minus IT, it is an interactive mode, volume mount minus V, and you make sure at the end here, RO. So whenever you're passing this, mounting it, make sure you put it as a RO read only, so that you will not, I mean, users on the container cannot be, modify. You can, users can't modify the system files, right? So I would like to just quickly show that. So when you pass it as read-only, so we can't modify the files in the host files in the container. Okay, so image authenticity. So do not trust any images created by others. Do not download any images that are created by others and use it in the system. So I would like to bring an example here. If you see that recent attack that happened on that has happened. So actually, certain group of hackers, what they did is they have created an account in Docker Hub, okay, and they have uploaded maliciously 17 images. Right? So that 70, whoever has downloaded those, actually it has reached the hit of Docker pull hit of 5 million times, right? So actually that was used to mine, to do the crypto mining. So they actually cryptojacked the user resources, right? And at the end of it, it actually happened in the span of 10 months. In the span of 10 months, the hackers could mine about, say, $90,000, right? So make sure whenever you create, whenever you try to download it, so, or whenever you try to push your images, you sign it using the Docker content trust. So it is actually one environment variable. You, if you enable it or export it as a Docker content trust, okay, so it will by default create two keys and it will actually sign your image and push it to the Docker registry. Okay, and you can actually test it out by typing a command if at all you want to use that, if at all you want to see whether the particular image that I downloaded is actually signed by somebody or the publisher who is claiming is the actual user, you can just type Docker trust inspect and then the image name, so that you will get to know each and every tag of the image actually will be signed by that particular publisher. So use trusted images. As I said that, nothing is foolproof. No company or no product company can claim anything is 100% secure, right? So since this open source technology, many people like bug bounty hunters out there, they keep reporting the CVEs. So every day there will be some or the other getting added to the list. So make sure whenever you are trying to consume the Docker images into your production, you scan that for CVEs and make sure those CVEs are actually addressed, right? So here you can take it as one good practice that you can create two repositories like Bad Apple Repository and Good Apple Repository. So if a developer is downloading, just make sure you enable a promotion policy. So if the severity level of the CVE is say low, so you can just promote it so that it goes into the Good Apple repository. And if any CVSS score is high or medium, make sure it goes into the Bad Apple repository. And a notification alert is gone to the security analyst or the concerned person so that they take a look at it and make sure they go through each and every vulnerability and see whether these are false positives or not false positives and ensure that, the CVEs are addressed and suggestions to upgrade it to the latest versions of the malicious open source libraries is taken care. Okay, so I'm not here to recommend any commercial scanners, but however, I just would like to mention that Docker by default provides your image scanner, which is only available for the private registries, which is a paid version. Okay, so do not expose unnecessary services or ports. So just restrain from exposing unnecessary ports and services. And make sure you actually limit. There is a possibility in Docker that you can actually limit how much a container can make use of the memory. So, but what happens is that since it uses the Linux kernel host features, so what it does is if it runs out of a memory, what it tries to do is it tries to kill all the processes out there, right, in order to run their system level commands. So it will not even mind whether it can even go and stop the process of Docker daemon itself. So there is a way that you can pass this as a variable to not to stop the Docker daemon. Also, there is a way to limit how much memory or how much CPU or how much a particular container can use it. So there is a way to limit that, and you can just refer to that and make sure you put it. And by default, as I was mentioning, so by default, Docker provides the app armor, SC Linux, and SECOM, but do not try to disable it when you are actually running the container. Okay, so all these things, whatever I discussed, it can be taken care in the orchestrator tool also as part of your security context. Like I was mentioning about image secrets, right? And also the mentioning the user, right? And also mentioning this profiles, right? So all this can be actually taken care when you are developing your pod definition file. So as I was mentioning, make sure you upgrade, you patch your Docker daemon, patch your images. Make sure your images are vulnerability free, and also your orchestrator is vulnerability free. Okay. So at the end, you have to abide to a certain standards and compliances, right? So Center of Internet Security benchmark standards are out there for Docker. Make sure you actually run this Docker bench security in your environment and see how your host daemon and images and containers are actually running, and make sure if it highlights any vulnerabilities, you can just make sure this is a Docker bench security. So you can just run this and figure out how your environment is actually created, right? Okay, so before I just touch upon this orchestrator security, in last year, February, have you heard of this Tesla hack? Tesla hack. So the main reason for Tesla hack was that a hacker was able to get hold of the admin console of Kubernetes, right? So it was a weak link. So if you see that the account credentials were just out there, right? So through that they actually used the resources of that particular Tesla, and then started using this for crypto mining, right? So if you actually see, there are a lot of orchestrator tools that are out there. But I would like to take Kubernetes as a example and I would like to touch upon it. Okay, so in case of Kubernetes cluster, so it gives you a lot of, there are a lot of components in Kubernetes, right? So the first thing and the main thing for the entire Kubernetes at the heart of Kubernetes is that Kube API server, right? So make sure the first line of defense for you is to make sure you secure or safeguard this Kubernetes API server and the host that is actually hosting the Kubernetes, right? And here, if you see anything that you do, if you want to create any pod, if you want to create any cluster, any replica sets or anything, the first thing that you hit upon is the Kube API server. Make sure you do not expose directly to the internet. So make sure you have some level of defense in front, like have load balancer, and make sure you do not directly expose the IPs of the API server, right? So, and if you see about Kubernetes security, Kubernetes does not support you to create the users natively. Okay, so what it does is it actually relies upon the authentication, external authentication mechanisms like username and password in a file, or tokens in a file, right? Or LDAP authentication, right? Or it mainly actually it widely supports the TLS certificates, right? As an authentication mechanism. So make sure you do not take the first two steps, that is mentioning the username and password and the tokens in a file and passing it as a variable, right? So, and also you can also mention, as I was mentioning, that you can clearly call out when you are creating your pod definition or deployment definition or replica sets, right? So, or the network policies, right? So you can clearly mention what security context, like secrets, whether you, from where you want to pull the secrets, right? So you can mention what user you want to run the pods as, right? So what are the capabilities these pods will, pods can have, and the network policies. So one thing that I wanted to highlight in this network policies is that, and if you are using a flannel as your network supporter, so it actually doesn't support you to mention the specific policy that you wanted to incorporate. For example, there is a web server, and there is an app server, and there is a database server. So there is, whenever the request is coming from the web server to the app server, it is an ingress. So app server making a request to the database is an egress, right? So what if somebody who is not aware and they try to configure it as connect directly web server to the DB server, right? So what if they configure it that way and there is a direct attack on the database, right? So you can clearly create your own network policies only when you use Kube Creator and not the flannel, actually. If you use the Kube Creator, you can actually define your policies, and you can clearly tell from which server, where exactly it has to go through the ingress and egress traffic. So you can clearly classify your network policies in that, right? So obviously, it supports a lot of authorization and mechanisms like role-based authorization. And image security, as I was mentioning, so make sure you scan it through proper scanners and make sure you actually analyze the images and use the safe images. And do not trust the images that are created by others, right? So this is all I wanted to cover in a short notice that I was given, okay? So I am open for any questions. Yeah, sure. I think they would be requiring this. Yes. Sure. Yes. You can also validate it once the image is created. You can, as I was mentioning, there is a command to test whether this particular image is signed or not. You have this content trust inspect a particular image, so it gives you which and all tags under that particular image was actually signed.
Okay, but is there like a third party signing that you can validate?
Yes, sure. It actually requires.
But
actually, as I think I just missed it, you have to actually connect that to the notary server. Make sure you are able to sign it. So once it connects to the notary server, you can actually it automatically generates a set of keys. So using that keys, you can actually make sure the images are signed.
But you mean, are you talking about the people who create the images?
Yes.
But
is
there any way to validate, like if I get a Ubuntu latest from Docker Hub?
Yes. So you can just type this command, Docker trust inspect Python or Docker trust inspect Ubuntu. So it gives you a list of the keys, whether it is signed or this is a proper authorized publisher or not. So that will be given. If it is not, it will clearly says that, it's not signed by anybody.
All right, thanks.
Hi, so thank you for the lecture. I wonder if you can recommend about some solution to pen test an existing Kubernetes cluster.
Yes. Sorry, could you repeat that?
Yeah, so I was wondering if you can recommend some solution to...
Solution?
Yeah.
Okay. So I clearly called it out, what are all the problems that are existing in this particular Kubernetes, right? So there are a lot of tools out there, but I don't recommend you to use the tools, because tools always gives you false positives. So you make sure you inspect, and with the limited availability of tools, if you can just figure out what vulnerabilities are there, yeah, you can just do it. So, and you can just search it, right? So this is just an extension that I wanted to cover. So there is no specific tool in my mind to recommend you that you can use this such and such a tool to do it. Yes.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.